are quite honored to have an anti-apartheid activist in our midst who suffered greatly for his work in the cause, but did amazing things, stood up when it was quite difficult to do so, and has continued throughout his life to stand up for people marginalized, the oppressed, all over the world up until today. I won't go into the details because he's going to speak a little bit about his life. I hope you did see, like I said, your little link, so you can actually see and read a bit about his life before that. So please welcome Father Michael.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be with you. I should just say on another subject altogether that I have a New Zealand passport and a South African passport. So when it comes to rugby, my team always wins. Good to be on the winning side. But congratulations to us as a nation. It was one rugby match that we needed to win. Talk about Israel-Palestine, but I also want to preface it with sharing a little bit of my own story, perhaps looking about the incredible great differences between Israel and Palestine and South Africa, but there's some commonality as well. Just to share a little bit, I was sharing with the headmaster the story when I was 10 years old. There was a my local church, the priest came with a petition. The petition was no Maoris, no tour. Because back then in 1959, the Springboks had invited the All Blacks to come and play in South Africa on one condition, that they leave the Maori players behind, the indigenous people of New Zealand. And that was my introduction to South Africa. Story about rugby, story about South Africa and New Zealand, but also about race and racism, about the relationship between faith and justice. And of course that story goes on in terms of the All Blacks and the Springboks, and has many different twists and turns. I was born in Aotearoa, New Zealand, brought up there. Then when I was 17, I left New Zealand and went to the monastery in Australia to train to be a priest of the Anglican Church, and also to join a community, a religious congregation. And when I was ordained a priest, my community said to me, what would you like to do next? I said, I would like to go and work in Japan. They said, that's wonderful, we'll send you to South Africa. So that was 1973. I often feel that the day I arrived in South Africa, I stopped being a human being and became a white man. Because suddenly, every single part of my life was decided by the color of my skin. So the university I went to, the suburb, the toilets I could use, the part of the sea I could swim in, there was no escape. So for me, whiteness became like leprosy. If I washed often enough, would it go away? And could I simply human being. So I joined the struggle to free South Africa, not as a favor to black people, but as a way of recovering my own humanity. Now you know from a little bit of history that 1976 was when young people of your age, black school kids, were shot in the streets of South Africa. More than 1,000 over a period of the year. And at that time I was elected to be the national chaplain for dying, who've been imprisoned, who've been tortured, and many leaving the country. Some looking for education, some looking for military training. And I was then expelled from South Africa, and I went to live in Lesotho. The famous Desmond Tutu had just become a bishop there in Lesotho. But it was in Lesotho that I then joined the African National Congress of South Africa and became a priest, a pastor within the liberation movement, living first in Lesotho, and then Zimbabwe. In 1982, there was a massacre in Lesotho. South African army came in, killing refugees and local people and children. And then I was away, but I was believed to be one of the targets of that massacre. And they said if I came back, the army would come back, and maybe some of them would be killed as well. So then I lived in Zimbabwe. In Zimbabwe, the government of Zimbabwe came to me and said, "Your Honor, South African government hit us. We believe the South African government wants to kill you. So from today, you live with soldiers, armed guards, 24 hours a day." So I lived in that situation. Now, when I tell you that story, you think, "Oh my goodness, he must have been very dangerous. Perhaps he was a gun runner. What was he doing?" Now, in fact, the only automatic weapon I ever used in my life was my tongue. So they were a bit stupid. They took away my hands, which I didn't need for shooting, and they left my weapon working reasonably well. Now, years passed, and the issue of apartheid became an issue of the whole world. You could go to virtually any country in the world, and you would find people who were involved in supporting the people of South Africa. And a bit like Israel and Palestine now, I remember talking in churches in the United Kingdom, and if you wanted to put the temperature up in the room, you talk about South Africa, because people had very strong and deep feelings, and people became very emotional. Now, 1990 came, and Nelson Mandela gets freed from prison. The apartheid government says, "We're going to talk." And my armed guards are taken away. So 3 months after Nelson Mandela was released from prison, I received in the post from South Africa 2 religious magazines. I'm a priest, that's okay, a religious magazine, you open them. I opened them, and it exploded. So it was a little bomb. And so that's how I lost both my hands, an eye, eardrum shattered, and many other injuries. For the 14 years before that bomb went off, I had lived in the countries of Southern Africa, Lesotho and Zimbabwe, but I traveled the world as part of the struggle against apartheid. So when I was bombed, there were messages of prayer, love, support from people all over the world, from Christians, from Muslims, from Jews, from Hindus, from atheists, from Buddhists. So in a way, I felt accompanied in my journey of healing. I also realized that if I was filled with hatred and bitterness and desire for revenge, they would have failed to kill the body, but they would have killed the soul. So I was able to travel the journey from being a victim, which I was, something terrible had happened to me. I was alive, therefore I was a survivor, to take the next step, the step of victory, the step of saying, I will continue to work for the land of my dreams. Now I came back to South Africa in 1992. I'd been away for 16 years, and I discovered a damaged nation. Nation damaged in our humanity, damaged by what we've done, by what put to us, and by what we failed to do. And that for many South Africans, all they had was their victimhood. And I realized that, yes, we could provide water and electricity and all those things, but if we were filled with hatred and bitterness in our hearts, we've not created a very nice society. So, with other friends, we created a process that we call the healing of the memories. Creating spaces where South Africans of different backgrounds could tell each other what was in their hearts. To speak not just from their head, but to speak from our heart. So, I started in South Africa, but we now work globally in many African countries. We work in the United States, we work in Luxembourg, Europe. I think about 14 African countries. Because in a way, every place on earth, human beings wound one another. None of us will walk this earthly life without getting wounded in some ways and by wounding others. The question is, how do we respond? I think also, as a white person, as part of the struggle, I think we were particularly hated because the regime expected black people to be hated. But white people, we were considered to be traitors to the white race. Where in fact, we said we are loyal to the human race. Now, let's come to Israel and Palestine. And I'm sure within this room, you've got different views, different understanding, different feelings, and also different knowledge. But we know the events as they happened. Of course, the history goes back a very long way. In some ways to 1947, the creation of the state of Israel, which didn't exist as a modern state before that. But the conflict between Palestinians and Jewish people had gone back long before that. And of course, we all know what happened to the Jewish people. One of the worst crimes of humanity ever, of course, was the Holocaust. And so then Israel develops a state what becomes Israel. But in the very creation of that state, many Palestinians became refugees. And in fact, millions of Palestinians throughout the Middle East. And I've been twice to visit Israel, Palestine. And I must say that I was quite shocked by what I saw there. And it reminded me in so many ways of South Africa, that in a sense, in the law and in the constitution, there were rights that Jewish people had that Palestinians didn't have and couldn't have. Not by attitude, but by law. Just as I, as a white person coming to South Africa, I could become a citizen of South Africa in 4 or 5 years and I would have the vote. I'd have the full rights of a citizen, which black people had never had up until 1994. So I want to underline the distinction between attitudes. So I can hate you based on who you are. It's a matter of my attitude, my racism, or my feelings. But that's different from the issue of a system. So I would say that there's a problem in the Middle East of the system. If you read the history, and even if you look at the map of Palestine in 1948, and then you look at it in 1967, and then you look at it now, it's got smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. And of course, a key to the situation there has always been the support of the United States. The bombs that are falling on Gaza today have made in the United States of America. Now, I want to be quite clear that what happened on October the 7th was an should or can defend it, say that it was somehow right, whatever. What is the response of the State of Israel? The State of Israel was to say we are at war. They said we are at war with Hamas. But if you look at the bombs and what happened, the war became against every single person living in Gaza. So now, what we've seen, and also remember, Gaza is completely controlled by Israel. So what do? They cut off the water, the electricity, and the food. So in fact, more than 2 million people were actually, and it's what's been happening, were beginning to starve. And of course, this situation is a hot situation. And we know there are many forces at play in the whole of the Middle East. There's the role of Lebanon, Hezbollah, Iran, the United States. So it's an incredibly dangerous moment for the human family, because it could spiral completely out of control. But not only that, everyone who was affected, members of Hamas, members of the Israeli Defense Force, and the communities are going to be scarred emotionally, psychologically, and spiritually, probably for the whole of their lives. And of course, I should mention as well, what was 100% unacceptable was taking of hostages as well. And I'm the president of the Healing of Memories Global Network, and we have come out saying very clearly that we totally condemn the act of terrorism on October the 7th. We totally condemn the siege of Gaza and the starving of the population and the cutting off of water. Today you might have heard the news for the second time, they've cut the media, they've cut the phone connections and the internet. So the international organizations are not able to deal with the people. So that's the situation at the moment. I believe personally that there needs to be a ceasefire as quickly as possible. Has to be the return of the hostages, and also there has to be the end of genocide against the Palestinian people, but also the world needs to come together to say there has to be a just peace that will guarantee the rights of Israelis, and a just peace that will guarantee the rights of Palestinians. People can make a comment, or you can ask me a question. But it's up. The floor is open to you. Present war, but when you read the history, it's happened again and again. Going back a long way. I also want to say that terrorism isn't just done by terrorist groups. Governments can also be terrorists in how they act. And like myself, I was a victim of state terrorism, or that of the public government. You have the phone. I just want to call President Biden. Well, again, it has long history. Also in the politics of the United States, the Jewish lobby is very powerful and shapes the politics, both of the Democrats as well as the Republicans. Many of us say there has to be a ceasefire. What the Western leaders have said is there should be a pause, lift humanitarian aid, and then people continue to kill each other. But that's also, if you're watching the media across the United States, there's been huge demonstrations saying ceasefire. Not a pause, but ceasefire completely. I couldn't help thinking what would happen if the United States, instead of saying, okay, we'll give you more and more weapons, they said, okay, we're gonna have an unlimited amount of money to create a peace settlement. A settlement that will guarantee the future of all the people of the peace. But instead, and I think like many of the conflicts in the world, Ukraine, Russia, many, many other conflicts. The people who are laughing all the way to the bank are the arms manufacturers. And they often sell the weapons to both sides. Yes?
They found out that one of the biggest lines of gas and oil lies under Gaza. So to blow up everything that is suitable for them to get all of the resources without them to pay for it and then just take it. So, yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yep. Hi. I'm just wondering, I thought you may be able to bring some insight to this as a member of the church. How connected are Palestinian Christians to like the wider community of, say, like the Anglican Church?
How
connected?
Profoundly. Earlier this morning, I had a call from Jerusalem from an organization called Sabil. You can Google it and find out about it, but it's essentially a group of Palestinian Christians. People talk about the, and one of the things we're saying that people are saying the Israelis have a right to defend themselves. Okay, agree. What about the Palestinians? Do they equally have a right to defend themselves? So there was a church that was blown up by the Israelis a few days ago. It's one of the oldest churches. One of the hospitals that was attacked is also an Anglican hospital. It's supported entirely by the Anglican Church. So there's a very deep, deep, deep connection with many of the churches. Interestingly, what the person is called the Latin Patriarch, he was just raised to be a cardinal in the Catholic Church. It's based in ask the question, because sometimes, and perhaps even here in Cape Town, we say, okay, there's the Jewish people on one side, the Muslims the other. No, we're Christians, we're also part of the equation. And of course, that's perhaps, you know, my feeling is that God weeps when God looks at Gaza and Palestine and Israel, because here are the holiest places, Muslims, Christians, or Jews, and we're in danger of, you know, war. I would have Suleiman, the head of Gift of the Givers, as our next president any day. but they are also involved in humanitarian aid. But I think what you're saying is also, when I was listening to this friend, and I have Jewish friends, Jewish Israeli friends in Jerusalem, as well as Palestinian friends. And when I hear their pain, I feel like how you express it. So all I can do is raise my voice, saying, ceasefire now. And also, as a nation, in the end, we had conflict from 1652. And in the end, what do? And so in the end, Israelis and the Palestinians will have to sit at the table. The tragedy is how many lives are lost before that. But we as a country believe in the procedures. So I think we should be using all our influence to call for those reconciliations. And of course, as a person of faith, as people of faith, whether we're Muslim, Christian, Jewish, whatever, we should be praying for the peace of Jerusalem, you know, and that there's a just settlement. Because history tells us that when people are excluded, eventually, my friend I was talking to this morning was almost in tears, saying, praise God, because the Palestinian Christians are completely nonviolent, and they believe in nonviolence. And they're saying, where is God? And of course, one of the worst things of what's happening at the moment is the number of children.
Jewish, Israeli,
and Palestinian parents whose children have died in the conflict. And they've come together to say, okay, we have these different ideologies, but we're parents, lost our children. So those organizations are signs of hope for the future. There are also organizations called Competence for Peace, and these are Jewish Israelis who have refused to go to the Israel army because they say this is not a just war, what we're making is not just. Just as you had demonstrations here of Jewish South Africans in support of ceasefire, in support of Palestine. But I think the question, I think many people in the world are feeling hopeless for good reasons. But in the end, the voices of reconciliation are the ones that have to triumph. Because we as a human family have no choice but to live together forever, as equally as the South Africans, as equally the people of the Middle East. Yes? Courage to change the things I can, and wisdom to know the difference. So sometimes we blame each other. So I blame you because your color is different. I can't change my color. I can't change the color of my eyes, even the shape of my nose. So those are the givens we find. But we can change society. We can create a different kind of society. Like South Africans could have said, okay, we will keep fighting until we're all dead. We say, no. So Mandela said to us, time comes when we have to negotiate.
Yeah.
Okay, yep. I see you've got good eyesight. If I say, it's bad for you to torture, but I can. Because I think one of the terrible things that happened in this conflict is that Israeli lives have been shown to be worth more than Palestinian lives. And for me, as a person of faith, I want to say that all lives are sacred, no matter what. Thank you.
Yep. Is there any way for the UN to step in to, like, get past the US veto, or is it completely barring the entire thing?
You know, that's one of the, South Africa's been advocating for a reform of the UN, precisely the way it's structured dates to the end of the Second World War, and the fact that the permanent members of the Security Council have the power of veto prevents it from acting. In the General Assembly, there was an overwhelming call for ceasefire, but they haven't been able to get something through the Security Council. So either the United States vetoes or China and Russia. So I think that's one of the a crisis for humanity. This conflict will be continuing, and the world seems powerless to be able to stop it. And that's why you have these demonstrations, huge demonstrations across the world in support of ceasefire. Okay, continue.
Can they reform the UN if the US, Russia, and China still have that power?
He's got yes. And that's one, and there have been increasing demands for that. But those who have the veto, you can imagine they don't want to give it up. But there has to be, if it was fit for purpose at the end of the Second World War, it's not fit for purpose. And there are now, you know, giant countries like India, for example, or the continent of Africa, that should be permanently represented in the Security Council. But you know, who are the greatest arms manufacturers in the world? The answer is the permanent members of the Security Council and Germany. So the governments that have the responsibility for world peace all benefit from war. And so that's a terrible contradiction.
So
I'm
coming
up
with a question that you're going to ask. So with regards to the dual government, when I say this, I don't mean like Israeli and obviously dual lives, but I don't think that government power should be granted to Israel, because in this context I feel like the history is very important. So if we go back to see how Israel was founded, it's an illegal state, so they shouldn't have government power. And with regards to Hamas, obviously, if I'm reading like the terrorism attacks, however, Hamas is like an independent group and it doesn't solely represent Palestine. And also, I feel like what needs to be recognized is that you also help Palestine as much as, like, it's like, you know, to win. I mean, not to win, but like, there's two sides, like, their friends, but they literally are the people who are involved.
In fact, there are three dimensions to Hamas. There's the military wing of Hamas, there's also the governmental dimension, and also a social welfare.
And then also, I think it's important to note that Palestine doesn't have a military force, they're not allowed it. So, yeah.
Under law, it's an occupied country. And part of the problem is that the international community has failed to deal with the issue of Israel and Palestine. And in fact, what's happening in Israel is that more and more settlements are happening Palestinian land, and that's part of the increasing conflict. Yes?
How long do you think it will be until this is in the region?
Do you have a crystal ball? I mean, I think that's where the whole human family has to come together, and particularly to push their governments to act. But in terms of our work of healing of memories, the healing of those wounds will take a very long time. But also, you need leaders with moral vision as well. Sometimes politicians end up being leaders who themselves are wounded. And so that becomes very dangerous, where you need leaders who have a moral vision, also a sense of common humanity. That's a good start. To admit that.
But I mean, because this is why it's happened, like this what is it all as opposed to like more than damage is being too much of that. Like it's innocent people that are being killed. They're not just dying, like that is so important to you. They're not just dying, they're being killed like for what people like. So in like our syllabus that we they speak about two options, a married state or divorced, so like two states. I think would it not make sense? So say now, for example, South Africa, if Zimbabwean refugees were coming to South Africa, would they get a state? No, they just live normally together. So I don't understand how that much is happening.
But in a sense, I mean, as my sister says, she's not quite sure, but also what that's where negotiations. The negotiations won't work unless you have leaders who are prepared to negotiate. And Hamas has been unwilling to negotiate, and Israel has been unwilling to negotiate. And hence we have war and conflict and thousands and thousands of people dying because of that. That's where I think the peoples of the world are oppressing their government, especially the government of the United States, because they are the only ones who have the power over Israel to bring them to the negotiating table. And that's, I mean, you know, the year that we became a democracy in South Africa, the whole nation was celebrating in 1994. Meanwhile, all this genocide happened in Rwanda at the very same time. And the world watched. So the world watching as well. It's a very, very painful reality. Okay, maybe last couple of comments.
I'm curious, talking about big powers and influence, with Britain, have they done any sort of had any influence on this? Because I mean, obviously with this history and having mandates within Palestine and letting Israel declare their independence pretty much. Have they had any influence now kind of trying to resolve conflict?
What happened in the last 3 weeks is that President Biden came to Israel, President Macron came to Israel, and Prime Minister Sunak came to Israel. And none of them calling for ceasefire. They're all speaking of temporary stop and then the conflict, and then the conflict would go on. Which is why the demonstrations taking place are so important for pressure on those governments. So I think in a sense, you know, beyond whether I'm Muslim or Christian or Jewish or Palestinian, it's an issue about humanity. What's happening there confronts all of us with what does it mean to be a human being?
Why are the US and the UK, what's their rationale behind the idea of suicide?
What?
Those two just started.
I think you see what I can't speak for them. I think it is historically they're one-sided in this, because you see it's also their failure to bring a proper negotiated settlement that watched it go on for years and years and years. But also if you read history, ask Ms. Google about the Balfour Declaration, because Britain's role in setting up the state of Israel is not a pretty role as well. And this is where things that happen in history continue, old wounds continue to infect the present. But also it's about, you know, Western military influence as well. It's not about the interests of the people, it's the interests of the military. Thank you for the question. The question, I mean, equally, if you say we want to destroy Hamas, why do you cause the death of more than 2,000 children? That's not Hamas. So you have this talk of self-defense, you have this talk of not attacking civilians, but the evidence is the opposite. I hope that you'll do some more research. Try and learn as much as you can about this history. But also try and, for me, perhaps the greatest tragedy of the Middle East is that if you read history, Jewish people had suffered for hundreds and hundreds of years of persecution, and of course in the end the Holocaust happened, and then for this people who had been victims then set up their own state and become the victimizers of others. And that's for me the great tragedy as well. Which is why it's important to, you know, heal our wounds. And I can imagine at home, your parents don't all have the same view, and that also shapes how we think. But I think it's also, at a school like this, it's important if you're Muslim, what you know about Jewish history, what you know about Christian history, and the same of each of the faith communities. We have a program in our institute called God Has Many Names. God Has Many Names. And one of the beautiful things about Cape Town is that historically, Christians and Muslims and Jewish people have lived together well. But it's also true that whenever the temperature goes up in the Middle East, it goes up in Cape Town. But please remember what I say is, don't blame each other for being who we are. But try and understand, not just with the mind, but also with the heart. And see that whoever suffers, it's a fellowship. So thank you very much for the opportunity to talk to you. I hope you'll go on talking and learning, but also being willing to not just talk to each other what we believe, but to listen. I think there was a reason why God gave us 2 ears and one mouth. I think God had something in mind for that. So thank you very much. I wish you all well.